Oh, pa tu ni thi mo na nang ma kong mo bui to pa ngai sut na te bo kalung sim te bo ai jong to pa tu ni ek gen ning tu kem lo to pa lam nang lan kanun pa nang khe la hi na ding to pa ta te pa ping ya ta in ka pai la mo le ka cha la mong ki bang sak ting ya ta in to pa lam na te nang ma ho pi na te mo sang ya ta in ka siang tho nang man nang sem ya ta in to pa o kamu nang nong kai sak de ka jang nang nong kai sak te o nang ma to ki som nang nong kai sak ki bo ze shim de ka hi ban ka pian ya to hi apoloma satani suksen nop nana ki bo ze shim to hem ki ya to hi nang ma nong om pian nang don pian te mo sang ya ta in ze shim da tu ngan kong kya bo to ba be sia no
Hi guys, how are you guys doing? Feel warm a little bit here than the outside, right? Who is ready to learn some good stuff, right? Life-changing stuff, yeah. Okay, we want to give a lot of time to our, you know, awesome Dr. Ma. So it is immense privilege and honor to introduce our speaker today. Dr. Ma is a Korean Pentecostal scholar, world-renowned scholar. He served in Philippines as a missionary for over 20 years. During that time, he also worked at the Asian Pacific School, a theology school, and at that school he taught you know, Dr. Hao Lian Ham and Xia Lian Boy, who is Xia Xian's father. So you guys know Xia Hao Lian Ham, right? Xia Lian Boy, yes. And after that, he also served as a director for Oxford Study for Missions. And then he is now a Dean of School of Theology at Oral Roberts University and a distinguished professor with his wife. It is truly a privilege for us to learn from Dr. Ma because he is one of the rare scholar in the world. Well known scholar. You know, it's so many people would come and pay to just to hear from him, and we just get the blessing and opportunity to hear from Dr. Ma. So why don't we stand on our feet and welcome Dr. Ma? Come on, guys. Yes.
Thank you, Pian. Have a seat, please. Thank you. It's quite an introduction. I'd like to meet the guy. It's very nice to be with you. I mean, it is always my special joy to come to the church, have fellowship. I remember one Sunday there was a huge lunch, and I couldn't believe that how many plates were being passed. It's wonderful. But I have to confess that every time I attend a beautiful worship here, I always wanted to speak to you. Yes, grown-ups are important, but for me, you are the future. So I always wanted to speak to you, really, but your pastor did not let me. He would rather me to speak to the whole congregation, which is basically the grown-ups. So it is my very special joy and privilege to speak to you. I have to confess that I do not know you very well, nor your culture, nor your language. So I will speak as an outsider, so I wouldn't pretend that I know you very well. However, I know enough of immigrant communities, and I know enough of the struggles for the first generation, second generation, and the generation that is caught in the middle. So many call them 1.5 generation. So Pyeong, you are there. So I know that a little bit. My kids were just like that. And I have worked with the Korean immigrant churches quite extensively. And I found some interesting trends. So I will share some of my experiences, but our text will be taken from, let's see if I have that. It will be taken from Ephesians 5. So do I have my PowerPoint? Okay, so blank for a while. I'm going to use a big word only now. Identity. Identity. Identity is a huge subject because only when you know who you are, then you can figure out what is your future. Now, based on this passage, Ephesians 5, now that doesn't look like, I don't think that's the right file. Can you open the other one? The file that may be called Who I Am. Okay, today and tomorrow I have 4 sessions. This session I'm going to talk about who am I. Next section, I am going to talk about where am I living. And tomorrow, the third session will be when am I living, in which time. Then the fourth, the last one will be, okay, I understood who I am. I understood where I'm living now. I also understood where, in which time I'm living. So the last will be, how should I live? How should I live? Okay, I know it will be coming. So the first one is, who am I? So you can imagine that when you figure this at least 4 things, your identity will be much clearer. Where am I? Where am I living? In which time am I here in this place? And therefore, how should I live? Okay, there was a plenty of introduction. So let us read the passage. It's the same passage that was shown. I don't know whether it will come soon or not. Let me read Ephesians 5, 15 through 18. I believe this is taken from NIV. be very careful then how you live. So it is already coming to the last point, how you live. And Apostle Paul was writing to the believers in the big city called Ephesus, which we are going to look at more closely in the second session, because it is where you live, right? And he was, of course, writing to the new believers. It's a very new believers, new Christians in Ephesus. So who they are, who are receiving the letter is already assumed. So if you read from chapter 1, verse 1, you will know who they are. Okay, so it is all talking about how to live. Be careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise. Okay? Making the most of every opportunity. Now, I'm going to spend some time for the last session on this, because this is quite misunderstood passage. Now, you need to make the most of every opportunity. Why? Because the days are evil. So it is saying which time we are living. Indirectly telling where we are living. Therefore, do not be foolish. It is interesting. Wise, foolish is coming constantly. And it already you can conclude, if you do not know the time and who you are, therefore, and which time you are living and where you are living, you are foolish. Right? I think it's a quite logical conclusion. If you know that, you know them, you are wise. It looks like I don't need to speak anymore. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is. All right. If you have these all elements to build your identity, at the end, you will know the will of the Lord. God's plan for you. You will notice that I will use singular words as much as possible. Although church is a collection of believers, gathering of believers. But in my sessions, I will speak to you individually, because you need to establish your identity before you are able to build a collective group that is called Burmese Americans or Zomi Americans. This is not on yet.
The last line is, okay, all right. Oh, it's on now. All right. Go on. Oh, you are fixing it. All right. Do not get drunk on wine, which leads to the wrong way, right? But drunk or filled with the Holy Spirit. So, looks like I'm preaching the last sermon first. I didn't do much, but it is more on the text we are going to read. Okay, Paul came to Ephesus, again, We'll talk more about the Ephesus later in the second session. And he spent 2 years in this city. It's a big city. Okay, if you can move on. And Paul, it was very unusual that Paul spent 2 years in one place. It is the longest time he spent in one place. The second one was in Corinth, which was about 1.5 years. So we have those the 4 points that build your identity. Okay, let's get into, all right, the first point. You are very complex. Your identity is really complex, but also that makes you really unique. You oftentimes may hate that you are overly complex. Am I a Burmese or an American? The culture clash is a part of it. So there are two forces pulling you to the opposite directions. If you are at home, you eat the traditional food because your mom cooks, right? And you speak Azomi, most likely. And the way you live is exactly like a back home, not much different. Difference, of course, is that your life is more convenient. You have a car, you have a bigger house than your parents used to have back home. I mean, the roads are good, and you can receive education, but still at home. It is more like back home. It is more importantly that your parents somehow expect you to maintain the language, the way of living, thinking, and even your future. So that is one force pulling you very heavily. I noticed that how you chose 2 songs. One is perhaps Zomi, the other one is in English. So that shows your identity because the other pool is the American force. And when you are in the school, you know immediately, even if you are surrounded by your fellow Zomi students. But everything is America. You are expected to speak in English, and you think like Americans do, and they will serve their lunch more burgers, salads, than your familiar spices with a dry shrimp, garlic and the chili pounded. Without it, you cannot survive. I used to have those pounded chili, and sometimes you put a dry small fish, right? Yeah, I used to eat it. So you have these 2 pools. Even in the church, somehow you feel this forces at work. You almost like feel that somebody should say, forces be with you. Now, in this, let's call it biculture, 2 cultures are clashing. the battlefield is no other than you. It is in your daily life, these two forces are coming and colliding with each other. And you are not very sure how you have to behave, which one you will pull, the Burmese or Zomi elements, and behave accordingly. And next time, how you can quickly switch to the American way. And that oftentimes brings a communication breakdown. And you feel that your parents do not understand you. And your parents are not coming to the game nights. They don't. Some may, but normally they don't. And especially their insistence on the way of life just back home is something you cannot take. Because reasonably you are thinking that you are not going back to Qin state. You will be living your life here in this country. So you feel that your priority is to be a decent American citizen first. And then, of course, preserve the goodness of your culture as much as possible. Am I right? Okay. I had a lot of talk with my boys when they grew up. They were running into this problem, although I never insisted on the Korean way that they should live, because we're living in the Philippines already. So they are called the third culture kids. Yours is a biculture, two cultures coming together. Now you have to decide whether this is a curse or blessing. It is all your decision. It's all your decision. And unfortunately, I noticed in whether it's a Chinese, a Vietnamese, a Korean, among the immigrants, especially the second generation, there is a pattern that in the beginning, especially in the schools, they just hate their home cultures. They feel that this has Burmese culture or Korean culture has no place in the United States of America. So I will become a complete American. So you do things that will look more like Americans. You dye your hair. Sometimes you dress the way that your parents wouldn't really enjoy, but you feel that you have that pressure. Now, in this biculture, each one of you is different. Because like a first generation, of course, they are all adults when they moved to this country. So they struggle, first of all. I think you should appreciate it. Imagine that you are just like your parents came to this country, little English system, completely different, but still try to survive. And they will do any job to support the family. You need to appreciate this. Think it will be well that tonight you go home, tell your mom and dad how much you appreciate them. they would do any work. Cleaning at night, working from morning till afternoon. And if there is another work, they will do everything. They will go to learn English. They will see if there is a better company that they could work. It is not a small feat. And your parents are doing it. Yes, they would love to speak English much better than they do now. They would love to learn more about American ways. But they do not have time. They have to survive and send your kids to school and prepare for the future and also send money back home to help their parents or cousins so that they could go to school. Or bring some of them over here. They have 100 different things in their mind. So you need to appreciate that they're living their generation, their dream, and their challenges. And you can imagine, they do not have a school to hang out with others. Church is the only place that they could do this, right? So if they come and eat the food back home, and just spend hours speaking to one another, let them do it. Let them enjoy it. Because from Monday, they will be again back to this grinding work cycle. And the work is heavy, and oftentimes the pressure from the work is unbearable, especially when you do not understand some detailed instructions given by managers. Just think. So, when you go back this evening, tell them that you appreciate them, their sacrifice. So that will help you because, you know, their struggle is same. It's the two pools, right? Of course, they do not have the native pool because they came with it. But their urgent agenda is to survive, to flourish, to prepare for the future. So if you feel that this communication breakdown is the sign of your parents' lack of interest, no. They are deeply interested. Some of your parents will say, we took all the troubles to come to this country so that you will have a better education and better future, and you will have a better life. Your parents will say that. So, you are blessed. You are blessed. And also think, another part of your identity in Burmese setting, being Christian is an exception. Not a rule. So it is okay to live in Qin state, but once you are in the lowland, like Yangon, finding a good job is already a challenge. First of all, you are a tribal people. You are looked down upon. You are backward mountain people. Then you are not a Buddhist. How much chance do you think you have? So that is, of course, the next discussion. Where am I, right? That shapes your identity. So you have experienced, and your parents have experienced a radical, radical change. And that explains why Zomi churches are flourishing and expanding. And also how Zomis are forming communities. Some Hispanics will disappear very quickly. Zomis would not. Koreans would not. Chinese would not. They wouldn't. Even if you want to erase your identity, your physical features, how you look, they remain. So, yes, it's a complex matter, but you'll do well if you decide to take these complexities as a blessing than a curse. Because you cannot run from your own identity. No, you cannot. Now, let's see, what is the next? Can we look at the next? Okay, so you are Burmese or Zomi American. Then you will try to negotiate how much Zomi I maintain and how much I will become American. 50-50 or 40-60 or 10-90. I think each one of you will think differently. If you want to please your mom and dad, there will be 80% Zomi. But if that's the case, how can I flourish in the U.S. society? That's a big question. Of course, question is this an either or? Is there a way to embrace both? I could be 100% Burmese and 100% American. If it's impossible, can I be 80% Zomi and 100% American? This is something you need to think through. Sometimes you may think, can I be just like a normal kid in the school? Hispanics seem to blend it in and disappeared, and you will notice primarily because of their features. Some of them look more like Europeans. So once they speak good English, they can be lost. I mean, they can be just blended in. Now, in this equation of who I am, the Christian identity comes in. It's important because you, Zomis, are predominantly Christian. But you need to ask, am I really a Christian by birth? Or am I a Christian because I have experienced Jesus as my personal Savior? This is something you have to negotiate. Just like perhaps more than Zomi identity, the Christian identity will have a long, long impact. So I hope that by the end of 2 days of spending together, learning and praying and singing, you will check on yourself. Is Jesus my Lord, really? even before American or Burmese elements of my identity, is he the most important one? You need to check on this. Okay, what is the next? Okay, now I meant to receive some of your feedback. I don't know if Pyeong, you can give your phone number so that people can text their questions to you so that we can do a bit of interactive discussion. Okay, send any text message to him, and we may be able to pick one or two. While you may be doing this, let me share some of the observations among Korean Americans. When I said 50-50 or 40-60, and you'll notice that some of your friends who lived in the places where there are not many Burmese families, they look behaving better among Americans than those who live in the place where there are a lot of Burmese. And this is what I like to see happen. And you can pray with me. At Oral Roberts University, I'm really excited that there are more and more Zomi students coming. My PhD program, there are 4 Burmese students, scholars. And I was able to bring in the first Burmese adjunct professor last year, Dr. Lian Sian Mong, near Chicago. And I'd like to see if some of you petition to the university to create an elective course on Burmese culture, history, and Christianity. You can take that as an elective course. And we have an adjunct professor to teach that. I'd like to see that happen. Another one is, someday I'd like to see a professor, a Burmese professor. It doesn't have to be theology. It could be math professor. It could be counseling professor. It could be music professor. And I'd like to see one very soon. This is something you need to agree to pray with me. And also I'd like to see that very soon there will be a city councilor from your group. I know your mom and dad are just putting every hour to make enough money. And they, not many may be able to function in this leadership level. Some pastors, I hope, would run for counselor's job, post. And, you know, think how many Burmese votes are there. I believe that there is a good chance if there is somebody who is willing. Who knows, Pyeong will run one of them. I think so. I think so. So that in the council meeting, your voice will be brought to the city planning policies. And when budget is set up, advocate for language program, for integration program, or to establish courses in the community college, unique for the Burmese culture and history. All of this, I hope, happens quite soon. I know your history is not long, not like Chinese, Indians, but the number is just amazing. And that is God's blessing too. And that's already suggests that your generation is not going back home. This is your home. This is your home. So it is important that you help your parents to understand what is required for you to be a successful Burmese American in the coming years. And if they insist on sticking to certain things, you need to ask, hey, mom, do you want me to speak a best Somi language but struggle with English? Is that what you want? If I'm going to live and work here in this country, help them to understand. Maybe they have not thought that far yet. But also, here is something I have observed. I started a little bit. Around the high school age, who are in the high school? Okay, all right. Some groups, some kids, I realized that they want to stay away from their home culture as much as possible. So they try to hang out with American friends rather than fellow Burmese friends. And the way they dress, the way even they speak English is trying to be as native as possible. That is fine. That's fine. But problem is that there is already a bit of a rebellion against your home culture, thus your parents, relationship is getting problematic. And then when they move to the college level, somehow they gain back their interest in their roots and their identity. I remember my son, the elder son, who grew up in the Philippines from 2 years old. So he never experienced the Korean living. And then he studied international schools and came to the States and California. He did a state university there. Only when he was in his university, he started taking Korean courses. To the point that he is now going, he is a missionary to the Philippines, but he is planning to go back to start the church for the younger generation in Korea. Now he loves Korean food, Korean culture, and kids love Korea. So it is good to see how he was trying to stay away from the Korean-ness, but coming back to it. So some of you may struggle in this area. What really helps is a Christian identity. Christian bonding, Christian faith is supra-culture. That means beyond any culture. And without it, I have to guarantee you, without that Christian element, your survival rate will be quite low. Whether in this country or maintaining this two cultural forces together, even if you may not agree with all the first generation leadership of the church, stick with it. Stick with it. And one day I'd like to see that some of you, yes, there will be politicians, there will be business people, there will be teachers and educators, and that there will be also ministers, pastors, and missionaries. Again, I look at some of the Korean 1.5 or second generation leaders. In California, I saw at least 5 or 6 churches that are independent and is drawing a large number of Asian Americans, second generation, into one congregation. One is about 8,000 people. It is interesting how, let's say that you become a minister, second generation Burmese minister, or you become an evangelist, and you start the ministry knowing that the existing churches will cater to the first generation, more or less. And you open a ministry, and that all of a sudden begin to draw Hmongs, Vietnamese, as much as Burmese, second generation, Koreans, Chinese, coming together. Just think. If you have about 15 Burmese churches in this area, mostly all of that are ministering to the first generation believers, and of course youth groups are there, and it's wonderful. And such a new ministry may be birthed within the church, where the first generation leaders understand the unique needs of the second generation, and also that the Christian ministry should go beyond the Burmese borders. Because just think how many Vietnamese are here. And because Christianity is a minority there, it's a churches in the outskirts, not like a Burmese. So you may have a Christian leadership potential, especially with this large number of you coming up and preparing yourself for the future. Okay, is there any comment or question?
No, I haven't received any.
Okay, you are shy? I thought you are not like your parents. Your parents will always wait quietly to see how others are saying, but you're not. Okay, any question? Yes, please.
Yes, so instead of stuck with our Zomi identity, you think that it's better to have a multi-identity that can receive any, you know, different, like, you know, Vietnamese identity, they have different identity, right?
Okay.
Culture, I mean, what I mean, it was culture.
Yeah.
Culture
is a very complex issue. Even if, the question is that alternative is to embrace multiple
cultural identity, not only American, but also Vietnamese, Burmese, and Chinese. Here is another observation which may be helpful. If you want to see a genuine Japanese, preserving the traditional Japanese culture, you need to go to Hawaii. In Japan, the culture has changed already, and it will be the same with Azumi. If you travel 5 years later, it will be different culture than the one that you or your parents know. So culture always changes. So when somebody says back home, it may be back home to 20 years ago, not back home today. So the parents should understand this. That is why the third generation Japanese Americans in Hawaii, they preserved the Japanese culture that their grandparents brought. So this is one case, but also going to your question, you can be best to remain as a Burmese. You cannot try to be a Vietnamese. You cannot, you have just one life in this world. No, I think your negotiation will be yes, knowing that you are Burmese, and God has placed some good things in your culture, good things. I noticed some very good things. Just think how generous your people are. Just think. Do you see the same thing in Americans? They will say, hello, I love you. But it's not really, not really, right? Not willing to share the small money you have so that, they wouldn't do that. So this kind of generosity. Another one is, of course, your extended family. Here, in the Western culture in general, one small cluster of family, mom, dad, children, maybe sometimes you include grandparents, but that's the family. Your family is almost like a potato when you started digging. Here's another one. So how many cousins do you have? You do not know. You cannot count, right? This is good. This is really good. Of course, it can be abused. When somebody is successful, everybody is coming. But this is really good. So, knowing that every culture includes a good and bad, see which ones that God has blessed in your culture. Maintain it and be proud of it, but also know where you are, and what your destiny is. And that will decide, how you can have the best of your culture and adapt social expectations here. Okay.
We got one.
Okay.
How do we take care of our parents but also grow as a Burmese American in this society?
Very good question, really. Very good question. Even before you ask this question, you are already helping your parents, right? When the letter comes from Social Security, it is you who will read it. So you are already helping. When they go to see the doctor, by the way,
we need Burmese doctors. Just think, we need Burmese dentists, Burmese doctors, so that the first generation Burmese will feel comfortable and receive the best service. So who wants to be doctors? We need some. Yeah, we need some. Yeah, so you are already helping. So it's not the matter of whether or not you are already helping. Now, as I mentioned earlier, oftentimes the communication breaks down because your expectations are different. Your mom and dad wants you to remain as faithful Burmese as possible. If you start losing some Burmese or Zomi language, they will become very worried. And how you dress becomes more the American side, that they will see, am I losing my kids? Because parents are rightly worried about the American society. Drugs, you know, how easily you can get hold of it without your parents knowing it. You know that. You're coming to the church with your parents every Sunday, but you can have another side of life easily. Because that's America. Good and bad can happen just like any society, but here it is more readily available. So parents would worry about it. Because oftentimes they will say, it is because of you we came. We had to take a long way to finally arrive here. It is for you. So when you somehow miss their expectations, although some expectations are quite unreasonable, but let's say the parents' nightmare is getting a word from police saying that your kid is in the police station. Just think. Your parents will dread of those kind of thoughts. So your parents are quite worried about your future, especially if you are not coming back home until 9 o'clock in the evening. Just think. So you understand that mindset, that worries, that priorities. So you need to not only respect it, but also appreciate it. You need. But also when we talk about communication breakdown, you have the key to open it. You have the key to open it. It's not your parents. They are tired at night. They cannot do anything because they need to get up early next morning. So I want you to take time. Say, you know, just anything. Just talk. If you are making a little money, take them out. They may not have tasted a decent American food. They may not have. So take them to places like even Starbucks. Just think, hey, $5 just for a cup of coffee? No. I would save this money for our kids. That's your parents. Take them out. Take your dad out. Said that, tell me about the grandparents. Ask. Communication is the number one, that you build and maintain a good relationship. And they would really appreciate it. They would say, no, that's too expensive. We can make a tea at home. But if you insist on it, hey, this is dad and me date. Let's go and have a nice latte coffee. You can put a lot of sugar in it for your parents, but they will really appreciate it. So it is really the communication, and stay on the course. I think a Christian faith is important. If the moment that your parents learn that you are no longer remain the faith, that will devastate their hearts. And sometimes they may feel, why did we move to the States after all? Okay, I don't know if I answered enough to this question. Okay, is there anything?
We have more coming. Now it's coming. Do you want all of it at once or one at a time?
One.
That we should not live in American culture, and I can't act like they act, but as a youth, we live in America and we grew up in this environment. What's your perspective in this situation?
Okay, they insist what they said may sound unreasonable. But they also know that your life will be different from theirs. And you will need to live in this country, competing with others to be successful. So again, the communication is the best. As much as you want to know about your parents, their daily work, their own struggles, and they even ask how in what ways you are able to come to the States. You just ask. Sometimes asking questions may open their hearts much easier than you try to teach them. They know that you will need to live in this country. Their worry is that you forget your roots, Burmese roots. So taking them to the school may not be a bad idea. I know it is difficult. Time is difficult. But if you participate in a play, ask your dad or mom to the school. Let them know. You know, the only thing they know is groceries, Walmart, and that their work and the church. That's all they know. Other places, it is more like hit and run. Go and come back quickly. But you are different. You are already within the American mainstream by education. You are constantly engaging with different cultures and also American mainstream. So again, I'm going back to the communication issue. Have an open communication. Feel free to share some of the struggles you are facing in the school. Let them know. They may, if you don't say that, they may think that you're having a good time in the school. And we are working hard day and night. Let them know. No, it is hard. It is difficult. And tell them, how difficult it was when you first went to the school. English is completely foreign, and you do not know even the small things like getting lunch. And so many things you had to overcome. Let them know that you also negotiate your own ways. And let them ask them to pray specifically for those things. Again, open up and make sure that your communication with your parents is getting better and better. And you have the key than your parents. All right.
Yes. What is your best advice for the next generation to grow and flourish?
Okay, that is something we'll continue to look at, because I want you to be successful. Amen. I mean, I want you to be successful. I want the Oral Roberts University, for example, is one school, to have a viable Burmese presence and contribution, not just numbers, but to the point that deans will come and say that you know what, we have 126 countries in our school, and I believe the Burmese maybe Nigeria is first, but I believe that the Burmese is the first, because those census does not include Burmese who are citizens. They are just put U.S. So by putting Burmese and Burmese Americans together, I believe that the Burmese student is the largest among the internationals. You know, the latest census show that in the Tulsa area, the traditional white is less than 50% now. So again, where we live becomes important, and how this change has taken in the last 5 years is also important. And that shows that you are the mainstream. You are not in the fringes. You are the mainstream. And you are here to build this country, really, and to build American churches. And I will have that in the next talk. So your success becomes an America's success. And that will also be a success for your country back home. And there is a good study that I'm going to introduce later. But be successful. God will have a different path for each one of you. But make sure that you become the best. The best. And you can do it. You can do it. Yeah, just one more and take a break.
Okay. How should we best preserve our own culture, American culture, and our religious culture, and balance all of them well enough to remain in them?
Okay, that's a good question. I mean, my wife will be better to answer the question, because she's a cultural anthropologist. As I mentioned already, no culture is perfect. Each culture is a mixture of good and not so good. Okay? So the best is to get the best out of your own native culture and the best of American life. Now, very unfortunately,
I also saw then that second generation immigrants. The selection was worst of this and worst of this. I saw that. Deeply involved in drugs. And somehow taking advantage of the relational culture of the Korea to abuse it. I saw those. But if you carefully see what is the best, what are the best elements of your culture, and also take the good ones in the American culture, if you blend these two groups, you will create something that everybody wants. Just think, if I'm a CEO of a company, I am going to hire new people. And my company has international operations all over the world. Now, am I going to hire a Korean American who looks like Korean but knowing nothing about Korea, nothing about Korean culture, nothing about Korean language? He's perfectly an American. Then his value is no much different from average American, right? But if you are a nurse and you're taking care of elderly people just like you look after your grandparents, which is not required for your job. Now, American nurses, they're kind, but once they are done, they go. But you somehow take another step to comfort the elderly people in the hospital. Just think. Next time you are going to hire more nurses, you may be approached by the manager. Hey, do you have any friends who you like to recommend? Now, this is the way how you become the best. So it will require not only your culture, but also your Christian identity, also knowing how American system works, right? Okay. Pyeong, I know that there are more questions, but we can pick up later. All right. I think you have a break, right? Lunch sounds good.
Wow, it was mind-blowing, eye-opening. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Can we share, can we give our appreciation to Dr. Ma? Thank you so, so much. And I know you guys have tons of questions, and keep it coming. It's going to be amazing. Make sure you take note and practice, not just the hearer, but the doers of the word, okay? And who want to pray? Who want to say grace for lunch? I want to. Anybody? 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 Say again. Jinni. All right.
Amen.
Okay, we're